Calimera. Si canis, cala? Thank you so much for the welcome. That was a wonderful introduction, and I'm deeply honored to be here and having a wonderful time. I've prepared a little presentation, which will be up in a second, and it's called Never Give Up. And I'm regretting it already, because last night when I came in, the host welcomed me, picked me up at the airport. We went out, we had so much food, so much drink, and I gave up. I said, I have to go to bed. I'm presenting tomorrow morning. So despite that, thank you so much for the hospitality. It's absolutely amazing. I wanted to tell you a little bit about Shazam, the early days, the story of an entrepreneurial journey, and just to be able to just tell a little bit about what that was like. And I know there's lots of entrepreneurs in the room, people are starting their businesses, people are growing their businesses. Please feel free to ask questions at the end. I won't fit everything in here, but hopefully it'll give you a flavor for that journey. So a little bit about myself. So I'm from India. I lived all over the world. My father worked for Air India. And I ended up in the US for my undergraduate, and I did my MBA at Stanford Business School. So I'm not a technical person, but business by background, and I've spent about 20 years in the digital arena. I moved from San Francisco to London, which is where I live now, in 1999, so I've been there for about 16 years. And the story of Shazam really is about almost being in the right place at the right time. I was in Silicon Valley just when the internet was starting up, and that's where I got the entrepreneurial bug. So let me tell you a little bit about how the company started and what we did, a little bit about how we built the business. So this is my friend and co-founder, Chris Barton. So Chris and I were drinking buddies in San Francisco. This was about 1998, just when the internet was starting up, and it was the boom of digital technology and anything is possible. So we used to sit around, drink beers, and say, we should be entrepreneurs. And it just sounded cool, but we didn't have any ideas, unfortunately. So we just ordered more beers and tried to come up with ideas, and mostly terrible ideas. And Chris, he was a really creative guy. He had lots of things which would pop into his head, and mine as well. And once he came up with this idea of being able to identify music. And his problem was he didn't know anything about music. So whenever he heard a song, he had no idea what it was. And his first thought was, it would be great if we could connect to every radio station in the world, so anytime you heard a song, you knew what was playing. And he was lying there in bed thinking, what would be better than that? And he thought, what would be better than that is if you could use your mobile phone to identify any kind of music, if it was on the radio or, you know, in a bar or a club, wherever. And so that was the idea for Shazam originally. So when he told me this idea, I said, it's never going to work. He said, why not? I said, well, because, you know, we don't have the technology for this. He's like, oh, we'll just invent it. Like, how are you going to invent it? Like, you know, he was an MBA from Berkeley, so he's not going to invent the technology to do this. So we'll figure. I was like, okay, so how are we going to find all the music we're going to have to, you know, use this algorithm for? He's like, oh, we'll talk to the record companies. Now, I happened to work in the music area at the time, and I know the record companies didn't have the music. And I was like, how are we going to get the rights to all the music so we can match, so we can provide the answer? He's like, oh, we'll figure this out. So I was not convinced at all. But I thought, you know what, I like Chris, I trust him, we get along well, it'll be fun. So I quit my job, which was a well-paid job, I really enjoyed it, and decided to start on this adventure, which really, if I look back now, it was a really stupid thing to do, you know. But if I hadn't, I wouldn't be here today. So I'm just going to keep going. So this was the original team. So Chris, who I've introduced, myself, a bit foolhardy, as I've explained, and Philippe, who's on the end, was a good friend of Chris's, and they were at Berkeley Business School together. And Chris said, Philippe is absolutely amazing. Okay, this man is he's a workhorse. He can do anything like three people in a day. I was like, amazing. So I'd never met Philippe. So I got into business with a guy I'd never met before. And I remember the first time I met him, I was in London. So I moved from San Francisco to London in 99, and we decided to set up Shazam there because there was the mobile phones were much more advanced. There was a lot more, the music industry and the music market was much more developed in the UK, oddly enough, compared to the US. And I met him for the first time, and it was almost like love at first sight. You know, it was, we clicked immediately. Now, the problem with this team is that we now had three MBAs with an idea and no technology. So we're like, okay, think hard, okay. We need somebody smart in this team. That's what this team is missing. So we need a chief scientist to invent this thing. And so we all like high-fived, and we started trying to look for somebody who could invent the technology so we could become proper entrepreneurs rather than just wantrepreneurs, you know. So I have to be honest. This is Dr. Avery Wang, who invented the algorithm which powers Shazam. Now, he would not be here today either, and I should say that Avery's still with Shazam 15 years later. He would not be there if he had not made a really silly mistake. And the mistake which he made was answering an email from Chris and Philippe. And they basically said, we're looking for a genius, you know, can you help? And he just ignored it, you know. But the thing about Chris and Philippe is that they were really persistent. So they emailed him again, saying, hello. And he's like, all right, I mean, what's the harm? I may as well meet with these guys. So how did they track him down? Because we didn't know the first thing about music technology, we didn't even know what domain we were looking in. So it turns out the field was digital signal processing, which none of us had ever heard of. So then we said, okay, so how do you find an expert in digital signal processing? I know you're laughing, but you know, it sounds stupid, but so it turns out, just dumb luck, that the experts in digital signal processing were at Stanford and Berkeley, and Chris and Philippe were doing their MBAs at Berkeley. So they found the head of the Center for Computer Research in Music and Acoustics at Stanford University, and they went and met with him. And they said, who are the best PhD students you've ever had? And Dr. Julia Smith said, here are the best PhD students I've had in the last 25 years in this particular field. So Chris and Philippe wrote it down in their notebook, and I've got a fantastic picture of this page of their notebook, and number one on the list was Dr. Avery Wang. So they hunted him down, got in touch, and said, we should meet. Now, the backstory to this is that they had spoken to a number of people in digital signal processing, and they tried to explain the problem. And let me tell you what the problem was. So we wanted to identify any song which was available using a mobile phone. So the microphone of a mobile phone is tiny and picks up all kinds of random things and doesn't pick up music from far away, just designed for your voice, with 15 seconds of music or less to match in real time against millions of songs in a cost-effective way and have an answer within seconds. That's what the challenge was. So when you explained this to people in 1999, they all said, get out, you know, you're mad. What are you talking about, you know? So everybody they talked to just threw them out. So Avery, who's a super nice guy and like unbelievably brilliant, so the mistake he made was when Chris and Philippe explained this problem to him, he hesitated. He said, and that was his undoing. Because they're like, that's the man, that's our man. He didn't throw us out. Like, he must be able to invent this. So we brought him on board as our fourth co-founder. So now, Avery's stuck with three MBAs, super energetic, running around, writing business plans, doing spreadsheets, talking to investors, going raising money, promising this massive business. And he's stuck in his basement trying to invent the algorithm to solve this problem. And he's like, after a few months, he's like, I give up. I can't invent this damn thing, you know? It's not possible. So he has a problem because the rest of us, we were not particularly good listeners. You know, we were enthusiastic. Never give up, you know, all this stuff. He's like, he was about to give up. And he was rehearsing his speech, how he was going to explain to us he can't invent it. And I'm not sure if this is a true story, but I think he went for a walk to get some fresh air and practice his I give up speech. And as he was thinking about it, he's like, wait a second, I have an idea. I'm sure it didn't go exactly the same. So he went back to his basement and tried this method to solve this problem. And he managed to crack it. Now, if you ask me to explain the algorithm to you, then I'm going to get off the stage right now because I can't explain it. But it cuts through the ambient noise, if there's noise in a bar, if you have background noise. It solves those problems by tracking over time a match with the information, the legitimate information, which is in the song. So the rest of us, we were super excited. We're like, fantastic. We have a demo, which we can go out and talk to investors and start raising some money and get on with building the business. So that was the next step. So this is one of our investors. And we liked him a lot because he comes carrying beer, as you can see. So we raised about $1 million in angel funding, which was great. It feels fantastic when you've got $1 million in angel funding in the bank plus two beers. But there was more to go. You remember I'd mentioned there was another aspect, which was building the music database. And unfortunately, I was right. When we talked to the record companies, they said, oh, you wanted a digital music database? We don't have it. And Chris would say, well, why not? You know? They're like, we don't. So now we're stuck because we've got $1 million from investors, a team, a chief scientist who's invented the algorithm, but no database. So you can't start. So what did we do? So we created the first database of digital music in the UK as a raw startup, which was absolutely nuts. Like, if somebody had said we'd be doing that, I would have said, how did I get involved with this? You know, what? So we hired a US Marine who ran shifts three times a day, so 24/7, digitizing the entire catalog of music in the UK, extracting the fingerprints, which is what Shazam uses to do the recognition, so it's not the full songs, and working with a team which looked pretty much like this. So unfortunately, I mean, all my material here is genuine. So that is my flatmate, Christian. That is our CTO, a guy called Mike. And that is my cousin, McCullough. So this is our crack music database team. I know it sounds mad, but we created custom machines which helped us to build the music database using crazy software methods so that we had what we needed to do, the fingerprints, in order to be able to do the matching. Now, this was all going so well. You know, along the way, we could have said, it's not going to work, it's too hard, but we didn't give up. Now, the problem with our timing was we started the business in 2000. 2001, we did our first round of funding, which is the venture round. And then this is what happened. So, sorry, I think I lost the signal. No. That spike which you see there in 2000 was the NASDAQ, hit about 5,300. The peak was in March of 2000. That's the week I quit my job. As the market started coming down, investors started getting more nervous. When you've got an unproven team with an unproven business, with a massive cash requirement, with a demo algorithm, just spent a ton of money on building a digital music database, things are not so good. And it didn't get any better. So what we had at this time was we had about 70 employees just burning through cash. So every month that would go by, we'd just burn more cash. Our first business model, when the product first launched, was a reverse charge text message. So you would dial a short code to an IVR. The phone would listen to the song for 15 seconds and then hang up. And you get a text message with the name of the song and the artist. And the number to dial was 2580, which was straight down the middle of the mobile. And I tell people about this, and they'd say, what's the number? I'm like, straight down the middle of the mobile. How hard is it, for God's sakes? You know? Or I'd have conversations, people would say, you should market the service. I'm like, I'm marketing the service. So we would burn cash like crazy. So the business model was just not powerful enough. So what do you do? So that's the point where everything is against you. So you can't get the business away. It's really hard to raise funding in that kind of environment. If you run out of cash, that's it. You switch the lights off, you let everyone go. And unfortunately, and this does happen, I've spoken to other entrepreneurs as well, you have the real possibility that the thing you started, which you put so much time in, which you worked so hard at, could be over tomorrow. And we went through some really horrible times, like having to let people go. I remember being in a cafe, and this guy came up to me and he said, "You laid off my flatmate." And I was like, "I did." You know, he was a friend of mine. Do you know what it feels like when you have to let go of your own friend? It's terrible. It's a terrible feeling. We didn't want to let people go. We had no choice. I met my wife around that time, and when we were growing internationally, we had to do deals. So we would do a deal with a mobile operator in Switzerland, for instance, and they'd say, "Oh yeah, we'll license the service, but we don't want to call it Shazam. We'll call it something else." So we lost our brand. And my wife said, "Why did you do that? You know, why?" I said, "We had no option." And those are the things which happen to all of us. To any successful business goes through those times and you just go, "Oh, it's unbelievable." But we didn't give up. We didn't give up until 2008, when Steve Jobs announced the iPhone. And the iPhone was a game changer. And the App Store, for us, was a game changer. And the reason for that was, you didn't need 2580 straight down the middle of the mobile, what's that number again? It came on a device which really took off. It came in the form of an app which was really simple, you just hit that button. It came in an app store where people had lots of other apps they were discovering and loving. And best of all was that Apple helped us to promote the service. So the TV ads at the time of launch of the App Store talking about what you could do and highlighting apps like Shazam. And once that started, then the momentum shifted. Then people are like, this makes a ton of sense. Then we started getting the traction and the uptake, and that was a massive difference to the business. So this is what the usage graph looked like over time. So I've cut it off a little bit at both ends, but I saw this slide being presented once by somebody from Shazam, and he said, "I joined in 2008, and you can see what happened, you know, and the crowd loved it. I joined in 2000, but nothing happened at all, you know." So what's amazing about this particular growth is that, I'll give you an example. So now Shazam has been downloaded a billion times. But the first, if you count the number of times it was used, so it took us 10 years to get it to being used a billion times. It then took another year for the next billion. The next billion took 2 months. So that's what that growth looked like, and it was all about being in the right place at the right time with the right device. And that, fortunately, has continued. So again, this is a little bit out of date, but in terms of the top 3 apps, we're up there in the top 15 or 20 of the apps worldwide. So I guess the story is, never give up, because it's been such a long time since 99-2000 when we started the business, and 2016 where everything is different. The music industry is different, devices are different, apps are different. But it's a real honor to be able to, you know, share the story with you, because I feel that we were a different generation of entrepreneurs, and it's tremendously exciting for me to see this generation of entrepreneurs and all the possibilities of making a difference to, you know, this country, the society that we operate in, you know, globally, and just making things a better place through the creativity and the innovations which are coming to market today. So thank you very much to the organizers for this opportunity. My best wishes to everyone in this audience who is starting a business or considering starting a business, and happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Dheeraj, for giving us some of the insights. You know, when we see a success story, we only see the tip of the iceberg. Thanks for providing some backdrop on what happens behind that. So can we take some questions? We have one from a very dear friend, Adonis. Can I get some mics here, please?
Thank you for being here presenting Shazam to Cyprus. What's the main income driver for Shazam, and when did that start, I mean, producing income for you?
Sure. So the main income driver, so we started, the original business model was to charge the user with a reverse charge text message, which was not a fantastic business model. And so we've switched business models a number of times along the way, which is, thank you for the question, because one needs to do that as markets change. After a couple of years, after the early days, we had deals with either operators or handset manufacturers, for instance, to pre-install Shazam on their phones. And that was a better business model than trying to charge the consumer. Once the app launched, then there was a freemium model. So there was a free version of the app, and there was a paid version of the app as well. And that was okay, but not brilliant. And then eventually, 2 or 3 years after the App Store launched, we decided to make Shazam free, which is a big, big decision, because then you take away basically the bulk of your revenues. But really glad we did it, because it drove the downloads. And now Shazam, as I mentioned, has about 1 billion downloads worldwide. And that base is a fantastic base for mobile advertising. So in between, when iTunes was in its heyday, Shazam was the number one contributor of revenues to iTunes. So they would sell $300 million of songs from people who had used Shazam and wanted to buy a song. And nowadays, you know, iTunes is less dominant. It's much more about, you know, streaming services like Spotify, et cetera. But the principal revenue streams are those referrals to streaming companies as well as advertising. So the business model has changed 4 or 5 times over the last 15 years.
Okay.
Yes, there's a question at the back.
Over there. Can we get a microphone?
Wants to disrupt the music industry right now. Mm-hmm. What they need to focus on? Because when you did, when you launched Shazam, it was like a disruptive startup at that time.
Yes, so about disrupting the music industry, I think
disrupting and making it better, by the way, not destroying.
So my view is that, you know, customer behavior changes over time, and so the underlying needs are often the same, but technology moves on. And I think that combination of understanding what is it that people really want, what is it that gives them joy and pleasure, but what's the medium which makes sense today is the critical thing to come up with fantastic products. So, you know, it's not about new technology in itself. It's about meeting a fundamental need. But it's about using a technology or using an interface where people, I just love it. And there's so much opportunity, because needs don't change. They sort of get expressed in different ways. But technology changes. I'm sort of absolutely fascinated by things like artificial intelligence, things like virtual reality, and I think these are going to be game changers, but it'll meet more needs which have been met in the past, and it kind of keeping on the front edge of that and really understanding is what creates disruption in industries. And the same industry can get disrupted multiple times in a few decades as technology keeps moving.
Can we have another question? Yeah.
Yes.
It's here.
Not on? Is it? Yeah, there it is. Thank you very much.
Sure.
I'd like to know if three MBA students decided to start a tech business today, how would you advise them, or would you be against it because it sounds like a bit of a impossible story?
No, that's a great question. I think that this is specifically about a digital business or a technical business, but I think it's really helpful for all of us to understand technology and to understand where it's going and to imagine the possibilities. I think it really helps to get to meet technical people and, you know, understand their point of view, how they think, you know, where the world is going. And it really helps to take the technology away and think about what's the solution for a customer and what problem does it solve. And it's those three things together which I think make for brilliant services or businesses, which is what's possible, how do we make it happen, what pain does it remove, and bring those three things together. So I would say, yeah, by all means, one can still do them.
All right, I think we have time for one more.
One more? Yeah.
Can we get the mic over there?
Hi. Thanks for your talk. Sure. How will you differentiate between never give up and keep pushing for your dream and don't turn your startup into a zombie startup?
Between never give up, pursue your dream, and what's the other one?
And not be a zombie startup.
Not be a zombie startup.
Yeah, because that's something that I have seen a lot of times. People are working on their startup for 2 years and they have like the same metrics and they are at the same stage that they were like 2 years before. So there is a fine line between that.
Yeah, I think that, you know, nowadays, fortunately, technology has become so much more accessible, much cheaper. The software development cycles are much shorter. And I think that, you know, if one's attached to a dream, then you can end up being a zombie startup. But if you're looking at, you know, are my customers really happy? Are my users letting me know that this is what they want? Then you're in good shape. And so I think the obstinacy is not about the product. You're going to buy my vision. It's more about I'm not going to give up on trying to make you happy. If you're happy, then I'm happy. And that's the difference between never give up, as in never give up trying to make your customer happy, as opposed to never give up on your single-minded vision.
Can we please have a round of applause, please, for Mr. Dheeraj Mukherjee?
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.